to Hillary, who's going to talk about some anti-harassment policies for this event.
Hello everyone, I'd like to begin by acknowledging that this event is being held on Indigenous territory of the Mississauga of the New Credit First Nations. We acknowledge that the traditional land that York University sits on was occupied and that the legacy of European colonialism and occupation informs the present-day realities of economic, social, political, and political marginalization of Indigenous people. I would like to also recognize that if we look around this room, the number of settlers significantly outweighs the number of Indigenous people, and we realize that our place, my place in this room, at this university, and on this land, is a product of systemic inequalities, and more than it is just of my own personal and academic achievements. We do not change the context, but we do recognize it, and that is extremely powerful. So as was mentioned, my name is Jillary Massa, and I'll be acting as the anti-harassment officer for the duration of this event. I would like to remind you all that while I understand that the topic of Palestine brings up a lot of emotions, you are expected to engage with this event in a discussion and in dialogue in a manner that respects the rights and dignity of those that are in this room. So I urge you to be mindful of the words that you speak and refrain from using language that is discriminatory in nature, and this includes language that is anti-Arab, anti-Semitic, Islamophobic, homophobic, transphobic, racist, sexist, and ableist. If you are here to disrupt this event, or if you are here in violation of these rules, I will ask security to escort you out of this room. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon everyone. My name is Ravda Hadal, and I'd like to welcome you all to the Students Against Israeli Apartheid's lecture on the Palestinian Nakba. So the idea for this lecture came as a request from SAIA members that Hammam Farah give an internal educational on the history of the ethnic cleansing of Palestine. This humanitarian crisis is often referred to as the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. But this is not a conflict between two equal parties over some disputed territory. But much like the civil rights movement, or the struggle, the Algerian or Irish struggle against European colonialism, or the Tamil and Kurdish struggle for self-determination, or the struggle of blacks in South Africa against apartheid. This is a conflict between occupier and occupied, aggressor and victim. However, over the decades, the mainstream media has played a significant role in covering this unbalanced relationship, but not anymore, thanks largely to the Boycott, Divestment, and Sanctions Movement, BDS, to social media, and to the vibrant history of Palestine activism. The world is beginning to wake up and realize the struggle for justice, freedom, and equality in Palestine. But that doesn't mean that everyone knows about the history of this conflict. It's more likely that your community members decided to join SAIA because of Israel's recent massacre in Gaza than it is because they learned about the Nakba, which is the root cause of this conflict. And so we felt it was important to not only give this lecture to SAIA members, but also to your community and to the public. It's only through our knowledge of the root causes can we truly understand the struggle for equality between Israelis and Palestinians. As many of you know, SAIA York is part of a growing global movement for boycott, divestment, and sanctions, or BDS. Our club was founded in January 2008 and has been a force for change on campus ever since. York University's mission statement cites a commitment to social justice. But we believe that the university has not fulfilled its commitment until it fully implements BDS. At York, this necessarily translates into divestment from arms manufacturing companies. Our divestment campaign doesn't only demand divestment from weapon companies that supply the Israeli army, but indeed all weapons companies. In the 2012-2013 year, after gathering 5,000 student signatures on a petition, SAIA was successful in pushing the York Federation of Students to pass BDS. The Graduate Students Association and the TAs and Contract Faculty Union, QP3903, also passed BDS. In addition, after being sanctioned for protesting York's investments in weapons, we have also taken on freedom of expression on campus as part of our campaign. I will now read to you SAIA's mission statement. We believe Israel is an apartheid state that resembles South African apartheid. Palestinian citizens of Israel are denied from controlling and developing over 90% of land because they are Palestinian. Palestinians expelled in 1948 and 1967 are denied the right to return to their homes and lands, despite the fact that anyone of Jewish background from anywhere in the world has the automatic right to become an Israeli citizen. In the occupied West Bank and the Gaza Strip, Palestinians live under separate and discriminatory military law. The Canadian government provides extensive political and economic support to Israel. Canadian corporations profit from investments and joint operations with Israeli companies. Canadian universities invest in corporations involved in Israeli war crimes and maintain ties with Israeli universities that are responsible for weapons research and land confiscation. We believe that justice will not be achieved without equal rights for everyone in the region, regardless of religion, ethnicity, or nationality. We understand Israeli apartheid as one element of a system of global apartheid. To this end, we stand in solidarity with all oppressed groups around the world, in particular, the indigenous people of North America. We oppose all forms of racism, sexism, Islamophobia, anti-Semitism, homophobia, transphobia, ableism, and all other forms of oppression. Our demands are based upon a July 2005 call from over 170 Palestinian organizations in support of the global movement for boycott, divestment, and sanctions. BDS should be maintained until Israel meets its obligation to recognize the Palestinian people's inalienable right to self-determination and fully complies by international law by 1. Ending its occupation and colonization of all Arab lands, dismantling the wall, and freeing all Palestinian Arab political prisoners. 2. Recognizing the fundamental rights of all Arab Palestinian citizens of Israel to full equality. And 3. Respecting, protecting, and promoting the rights of Palestinian refugees to return to their homes and properties as stipulated in UN General Assembly Resolution 194. Now I will introduce to you our speaker, Hammam Farah. Hammam is a York alumnus and a Palestinian activist based in Toronto. His family's resilience in Gaza doesn't only serve as a source of inspiration for him, but also all of us here at SAIA. He is a member of the Coalition Against Israeli Apartheid, a founding member of Amnesty International at York, former coordinator of the Student Christian Movement at York, former song director for the York Federation of Students, and a founding member of Students Against Israeli Apartheid at York University. Hammam was given a year-long trespass notice by administration in 2013 because he exercised his right to freedom of expression by protesting York's investments in weapons. While he was banned, he spent much of his time researching York's decision-making structure, its policies, and its vision. And so when he came back to us in September, he brought back many of these valuable lessons that we then put into action. And the results are pretty obvious to anyone paying attention to the current events at York University. Our Why You Divest campaign has been remarkable. So much so that we've been recently subject to a barrage of intimidation and harassment from those who support investments in weapons. But we will not be intimidated or silenced, and we'll continue our work for a better Europe, a Europe that fulfills its statement to social justice. And so finally, it's my pleasure to welcome you, Hammam Farah.
Thank you, Ragta. So we weren't able to book a mic for this room. If anybody would like me to raise my volume, please let me know at any time throughout this lecture. Also, please put your phones on silent.
One thing. We understand people have things to do. If you need to leave, we understand. Just quietly exit the room. No personal offense taken.
That was a good day.
Thank you.
So I'm going to give this lecture, and then I'm going to show two slideshows. So this lecture is an introductory one. It's an introductory lecture, and you know, if people want to learn more about the advanced stuff of the details of what's happening in Palestine and what took place throughout the history, then I would encourage you to do so after having getting the basics of the conflict from this lecture. So this is so welcome to this introductory lecture on the colonization and ethnic cleansing of Palestine. There is a plethora of historical records about the tragedy of Palestine. And what isn't commonly known is that in the 1980s, Israel declassified its military records of the events of 1948, including the orders given by Zionist leaders to remove thousands of Palestinians from their homes. The declassified military archives were like a treasure chest for a group of Israeli historians who became known as Israel's new historians, because they were able to provide new information about Israeli history. But that information wasn't new to Palestinians. In fact, what these historians found in the military records largely confirmed and corroborated the accounts of Palestinian historians and Palestinian survivor testimony. One of these Israeli historians is Ilan Pape, who relied on the declassified archives and on Palestinian eyewitness testimony, and published his masterpiece book, The Ethnic Cleansing of Palestine, in 2006. I have that book with me. On the table. So I'll just show you these three books I have. This is The Ethnic Cleansing of Palestine by Ilan Pape, Israeli historian. This is a book called Israel, a Colonial Settler State by Jewish-French intellectual Maxime Rodinson. This is an old one. It was written in 1979, I believe. And this book here is called All That Remains. It's by Palestinian historian Walid Khalidi. This book is an encyclopedia, literally, an encyclopedia of 500 Palestinian cities, towns, and villages that were depopulated in 1948 by Zionist forces. And if you look into the pages, you'll see that each section has the districts in Palestine, each village and city and town, its map, and details and statistical details, such as how many people were living there, how many were expelled, the method of expulsion that took place, and what happened to them afterwards, and whether they even exist today or not, because many of these villages were burned to the ground and bulldozed, or they were given over to European Jewish settlers.
Chopstick
is a must. So although Ilan Pape became an anti-Zionist the more he learned, another new historian by the name of Benny Morris did not. This didn't mean that Morris denied the ethnic cleansing, as many Zionists are taught to by the Israeli government and traditional Israeli historians. On the contrary, he acknowledged and recorded the ethnic cleansing in his book, The Birth of the Palestinian Refugee Problem. But unlike Pape, he not only held on to his Zionist ideas, but he also refused to use Palestinian testimony, even though historians rely on people's testimonies as standard practice. But all he needed was the Israeli military's own records, and he believed that Zionist forces should have continued to drive out Palestinians until they were all expelled, because according to him, it would have saved Israel from what Israeli officials refer to as the demographic time bomb, which I will get to later in this talk. The point here I'm trying to make is that even some Zionist historians have acknowledged the events of 1948. There is another book, which I don't have here with me, unfortunately. It's called Blood and Religion by British journalist Jonathan Cook. This one really helped further my understanding of the situation, because he had a framework, he used a framework of numbers, of population, a demographic framework. And there's a chapter in his book called The Battle for Numbers, which effectively explains the demographic motivations of political Zionism. So what I hope that you will understand from this talk is how much population and numbers means to the Israeli government. And that this whole conflict, if you will, is all about, all boils down to an issue of demography, an issue of numbers, where the Zionist movement's motivation from then until today is the preservation of a Jewish majority state. And the word majority here is very important for us to understand. It's not necessarily a state of only Jews, as Benny Morris wanted, but a state where Jews are the majority and they are able to maintain that majority status. Why? Because Israel is a liberal democratic state. And if it's a liberal democratic state, it means that the power of the majority has the power of the vote. And that's how the Zionist movement planned to ensure a Jewish state in Palestine, by sustaining that majority of Jews at any and all costs, even if it meant the expulsion and taking away the rights of people who actually were the majority in 1947 and were reduced to a minority by 1949. In 1973, the French Jewish intellectual Maxime Rodinson wrote a short book called Israel, a Colonial Settler State, one of which I showed you. In the introduction, Peter Buck states that Rodinson traces the origins and mentality of Zionism to the conditions of 19th and 20th and early 20th century Europe, when capitalism went through a period of great expansion and empire building, which finally led to the First World War, unfurling the banner of a universal European civilizing mission. The European powers surged into the underdeveloped world, annexing colonial territories and mercilessly exploiting the subjugated peoples who were put to work on plantations and in mines to help in the looting of their own countries. But the Zionist nationalists, unlike other European colonialists, had to create a social base as well as take over a national territory. According to the academic Bill Ashcroft, there is a distinction between occupation colonies, where the purpose is holding territory, and settler colonies, where the invading Europeans or their descendants annihilated, displaced, and/or marginalized the indigenous people to become a majority non-indigenous population. So having said that, we start our story in the 1800s. Jewish persecution in Europe. And we must acknowledge the long history of persecution and anti-Semitism in Europe. Has the European Jewish community thinking about Jewish liberation? Most thinkers advocated for Jewish resistance against oppression until Europe recognized and respected their rights. But a minority of intellectuals, led by Austrian journalist Theodor Herzl, advocated for Zionism. And Zionism's general definition means the national movement for the return of the Jewish people to their ancient homeland and the resumption of Jewish sovereignty in the land of Israel. Herzl linked the idea of Zionism to the idea of the nation state. So whereas Zionist intellectuals used to debate what, you know, so this definition of Zionism, it's brief, but we can also have debates about what that means. Maybe it's an inner struggle. Maybe it could manifest in many ways. But Herzl, unlike other Zionists, he advocated for a physical manifestation where Jews would actually be moved from one region of the world to another in order to establish a physical Jewish state. So under that thinking, Jews weren't defined merely as a religious group, but as an ethnicity or an ethno-religious group. Herzl wrote the book Der Judenstaat, or The Jewish State, and he believed that the solution to anti-Semitism and the only way that Jews would be safe in the world is within a Jewish state. This became known as political Zionism. Although a few options were considered for the location of that state, Palestine was decided upon because of its historical and biblical significance to the Jewish people. But as history has shown, a nationalism that is calling for the formation of a nation state by physically relocating its people from one geographical region of the world to another leads to failure and bloodshed. Herzl convened the first Zionist Congress in Basel, Switzerland in 1897, outlining the goal of establishing a Jewish home in Palestine. And here I quote Herzl. Were I to sum up the Basel Congress in a word, which I shall guard against pronouncing publicly, it would be this. At Basel, I founded the Jewish state. Herzl adopts colonialism as the process of establishing a Jewish state in Palestine. See, the use of colonial language and its normality as a common terminology of civilized people of the time, or civilized people is what I'm trying to say, I hope you're catching on to that. Civilized people of the time was common knowledge, was common use. So Herzl, for example, Herzl lobbied the Ottoman Empire, or the Turkish Empire of the time, that ruled over the Middle East. And here I quote him again. And he told the Ottoman Emperor, if you allow us to go into Palestine, we shall serve as the outpost of civilization against barbarism. And Herzl wrote, we must expropriate gently the private property on the state assigned to us. We shall try to force the penniless population across the border by denying it employment. Both the process of expropriation and the removal of the poor must be carried out discreetly and circumspectly. So you can see the European classic 19th century European colonial language being utilized by the Zionist movement and the links the Zionist movement had built with colonial powers, first the Ottomans and then the British, as I will get to shortly. It is said that Herzl's colleague, Max Nordau, sent two rabbis to Palestine to investigate the prospects of a Jewish state there. They sent a report back to Herzl, which concluded that the bride is beautiful, but she is married to another man. I.e., Palestine was already inhabited. Nevertheless, Zionists at the time popularized the idea of Palestine as a land without a people, for a people without a land. And this became a popular quote. Now we shift to Palestine. In the 1800s, Palestine was a province of the decaying Ottoman Empire. But Palestinians were a community of Muslims, Christians, and Mizrahi Jews. Indeed, Jews who considered themselves Palestinian Arabs. And they were living together in harmony, despite the oppression of the Ottoman Empire. And their history went back thousands of years to the ancient times of the land of Canaan. In the 1800s, however, European Jewish settlement began and was sponsored by French aristocrat Baron Edmond de Rothschild, who bought plots of land from wealthy Arab landowners in order to realize that settlement. In 1908, the Jewish Agency was established by the Zionist organization to take over from Rothschild and facilitate European Jewish settlements in Palestine. The Jewish National Fund, or JNF, was also set up to acquire land in Palestine. The JNF has a land and afforestation department, which by some accounts used to be called the Colonization Department, but changed its name to Land and Afforestation Department when colonization became a bad word. The JNF is still active today, building parks over demolished Palestinian villages. Many of its leaders are also in the Israeli government's Israel Lands Authority. And despite its charter stating that land can only be sold to Jews, it shamefully has charitable status here in Canada. And if anybody is interested in joining Palestine Solidarity Activism after this lecture, there is a campaign trying to stop, to remove the JNF from having charitable status in Canada. You can ask me about that. I can connect you with people in Toronto that are working on it. But going back to the 1800s, when the Jewish Agency was acquiring land, there was, they came, the way they did it, so the way it worked was that there was the Ottoman land laws that were passed by the Ottoman Empire in 1858. And the way the Ottoman land laws worked was that if you buy land from, you didn't have to, sorry. So what happened was that there were people living on land, farmers, Palestinians, were living on farms and farming, tending the land, the Palestinian peasants. However, the land was owned by wealthy Palestinian or Arab landowners from outside Palestine, some of whom have never even been on their land. So what would happen was that they would sell their land to the Jewish agency, and what would happen was that the Jewish agency would then fire all the farmers, all the peasants that had been living there for centuries, and in favor of replacing them with Hebrew labor, or the concept of Hebrew labor as it was known back then. So the Jewish agency adopted this concept of Hebrew labor that said that only Jews can be allowed to work in land that was acquired by the Jewish agency. And so when they bought land from wealthy Arab landowners, they would expel all the farmers and peasants that have been living there for hundreds of years. And this upset, obviously really upset, eventually farmers had to take matters into their own hands, because obviously the Ottoman land laws weren't helping. And this was what started the first clashes between European Jewish settlers and indigenous Palestinians. These clashes continued until 1948, and sometimes they were characterized by bloody riots and looting on both sides. World War I happens, and Britain and France take over the Middle East. The Sykes-Picot Agreement happens in 1916. A British official, Lord Sykes, and a French official, Picot, they get together and literally take a ruler to a map and draw out the lines that the Middle East is going to look like. And the countries we know today in the Middle East are based on that carving up. And that obviously has caused a lot of problems. As we all know, the Middle East has been in turmoil since then. The British take over Palestine under the British Mandate in 1920. And the British Mandate means that Britain will control a territory until they feel that the indigenous people in the territory are responsible enough to govern themselves. And there was British and French mandates all over the Middle East at the time. We refer to it as the British occupation of Palestine. In 1917, the Balfour Declaration takes place. And the Balfour Declaration is when the Foreign Secretary of Britain, Lord Arthur Balfour, writes a letter to the Zionist movement saying that His Majesty's government views with favor the establishment of a national home for the Jewish people in Palestine. And this was an official endorsement by the British Empire to the Zionist movement. The British thought that they could control the Middle East by establishing a European outpost, as Herzl was saying to the Ottoman Emperor prior to that. The British took that on. They accepted Herzl's proposal, and they thought that it would be beneficial for their empire if they had a European outpost smack in the middle of the Middle East. So then waves of Jewish immigration began, and it intensified during the Nazi Holocaust, in which at least 6 million Jews were murdered by Hitler's regime. As a result of the Holocaust, Zionism gained in popularity and among the majority of Jews in Europe. They were now convinced that they had no place in Europe, that assimilation with non-Jews had failed, and that they should now leave to Palestine which was being promoted by the Zionists as a paradise in the desert, awaiting its people to come home. Making the desert bloom was the phrase that was used. It was a common phrase used to describe the way that Jewish colonists were building their homes and farms in Palestine, which was supposedly empty, arid desert, waiting for a hard-working people to make it bloom. Never mind that Palestinians and industries such as soap and orange industries, they had high standards of education and a railway station, and even a wealthy middle class. In 1936 to 1939, the Palestinians revolt against the British and the Balfour Declaration. The British crush this revolt. Palestinian leaders are exiled. The population is defeated. Sometimes Palestinians refer to the 1936 revolt as the very first Intifada. And crushing that revolt weakens the Palestinian people to such an extent that this set the stage for their defenselessness during the Nakba in 1948. In the 1920s, the Haganah is formed. The Haganah was the official military forces or militia of the Jewish agency in Palestine. In the 1940s, Zionists take up terrorist methods. The Irgun and the Stern gangs are formed. They are more hardline than the Jewish agency. They don't agree with establishing just a Jewish state. They want more. They want to expel everybody. They plant bombs in milk cans in Palestinian markets. So they blow up the King David Hotel while British officials are meeting. And their main concern, I think, was that they disagreed with negotiations between the Jewish agency and Britain. They did not want that to happen. They wanted to force the British to give them a Jewish state. That's what it was. They wanted to force the British by pressuring them through these violent actions. Whereas the Jewish agency preferred to continue negotiations first and see how that goes with the British. The British eventually gave up. They gave responsibility of Palestine over to the United Nations, which was newly formed. The United Nations passed Resolution 181. Resolution 181 is what we refer to as the Partition Plan. And the Partition Plan was a proposal by the UN that said that about 60% of Palestine would go to a Jewish state, and about 40% would go to a Palestinian state. Although, by 1947, and this is important, by 1947, the Jewish agency was not able to acquire a significant amount of land through buying, through purchase. They were only able to acquire 5 to 7% of the land. 5 to 7%. Yet the UN proposed about 60% of Palestine should be given to the Zionist movement for a Jewish state. The Jewish agency accepts this proposal. However, David Ben-Gurion has a problem. And David Ben-Gurion is the leader of the Jewish agency at the time, who became Israel's first prime minister. David Ben-Gurion has a dilemma. The population of the population inside what was to become a Jewish state was roughly equal in number between Jews and Palestinians. About 50-50. And this was a problem, because if the population is about 50-50, how are you going to have a Jewish state? How can you declare a Jewish state over an area where almost half your population is not Jewish? and then call yourself democratic. This was a reality that David Ben-Gurion was confronted with, that today many Zionists, I assure you, don't even know about this little fact. If the Palestinians had accepted the partition plan, Israel wouldn't even exist. You know, we're constantly being accused of rejecting the plan back in 1947. But if we had accepted it, Israel wouldn't even exist, because Israel would have been established on an area where half the population was Palestinian. You couldn't have a Jewish majority. It wasn't going to happen. And David Ben-Gurion knew that. And so Zionist leaders were discussing the idea of what they called compulsory transfer, which was a euphemism for ethnic cleansing. In 1940, Joseph Weitz of the JNF stated, "Between ourselves, it must be clear that there is no room for both peoples together in this country. We shall not achieve our goal of being an independent people without the Arabs in this small country. The only solution is Palestine without the Arabs. And there is no other way but to transfer the Arabs from here to the neighboring countries. To transfer all of them. Not one village, not one tribe should be left." And indeed, in 1947, David Ben-Gurion began to put this plan into motion. And the most intense part of this plan was called Plan D, or Plan Dalit, which orders, direct orders for ethnic cleansing were given to Zionist militia. There was an operation called Operation Broom. Operation Broom, the purpose was to sweep away the villages of Palestinians. And so, in 1947, the Haganah blows up two villages. And the way they used to do it, the way they also did things, was that they would roll a barrel, they would set a barrel on fire and roll it down a hill, and the barrel would roll into a Palestinian village. People would come out to put out the fire in a frenzy, and they would be sniped by Haganah snipers from the hills. Other methods they used was that they would bring, they actually did this, they brought loudspeakers with sounds of screams into the front of the village to scare people. And they would announce, "You need to leave now before we come and kick you out. You need to leave." Things got more intense as 1948 arrived. In April 1948, the village of Deir Yassin was massacred by the Irgun gang, Irgun and Stern gangs. About 100 people, men, women, and children, were killed, including pregnant women. This is documented. I should give a trigger warning. We're going to talk about violence, graphic violence. Pregnant women were bayoneted. I don't know if everybody knows what that means, but World War I, the guns had knives coming out of them. They're bayonets, that's what they were called. And you would stick it in the person's stomach and do this kind of movement to kill them. And the Irgun utilized this to kill pregnant women in the village of Deir Yassin. This massacre scared a lot of people. The media, the Palestinian media, was in a frenzy about it. A lot of people were scared. The story was exaggerated. There were a lot of fears that came out of it. And then people started to flee their homes because of fear. And the Irgun even acknowledged that this was part of the plan. They wanted to do something that would scare the Palestinians into leaving. And this is what they did. Throughout this year, the Haganah gave orders also to evacuate the city of Lid and the city of Ramlid. The commander that was given these orders was Yitzhak Rabin, who later signed the peace process with the Palestinians in 1993. These cities, and I do mean they were cities, 30,000 people was their population. I think one was 20,000, one was 30,000. They were evacuated by military order. Its people were death marched across the border. 3 days they had to march. Some died of thirst. Others had to drink their own urine to survive. The elderly were shot. The disabled were shot. And there were several massacres that are documented that occurred throughout that year as well. Several other massacres. In May 1948, David Ben-Gurion declares the establishment of the State of Israel. 200,000 Palestinians had been expelled. He felt that this was the time where the Jewish agency had finally achieved its goal of forcing a Jewish majority to exist in Palestine. Finally, they were a majority. He didn't feel that he needed to expel all Palestinians. That's why we have Palestinians who are citizens of Israel today. Those are the ones who had remained, who were not expelled. But they are a minority today. And he had achieved his goal of forcing, by blood, by massacre, a Jewish majority in Palestine. And then he declared the establishment of the State of Israel. This is, as the Zionist narrative then tells us, that five Arab armies attacked the newly formed Jewish state with the intent of destroying it. The reality is that these Arab armies intervened because of two things. One, because 200,000 Palestinians had already been expelled, and the Arab population in the rest of the Middle East, they were protesting in the streets, pressuring their governments to do something about it before it gets worse. The second reason they intervened was that Israel was established not on about 60% that the UN had suggested, but 78% of Palestine. Therefore, Israel violated the UN resolution that proposed to create it. It violated Resolution 181 by establishing itself on more land than the resolution had proposed. 78% of Palestine had just become the State of Israel. So the Arab armies finally intervened. They were too late. Not only were they too late, but they were ill-equipped. They had old Ottoman guns, while the Haganah was trained by the British Empire. They had updated British guns that were used in World War II. And on top of that, the Arab regimes, and we all know they don't care. They sent like 2,000 people each, something like that. Jordan had a lot of soldiers, but Jordan signed a deal with the Haganah, signed a deal with David Ben-Gurion, and so they were neutralized. Jordan was the only country that may have been able to do something because they were trained by the British as well, but they signed a deal, and they weren't involved anymore. And the rest of the Arab countries barely sent in enough people to defend the ethnic cleansing of Palestine. And so they were defeated. this series of events, the massacres, the expulsions, the mass expulsion, it resulted in 750,000 Palestinians were expelled from their homes. And the thing is that expulsion isn't necessarily, you know, telling someone to leave at gunpoint. Expulsion is also denying somebody their right to return. So there's this debate going on in Israel over how many people were expelled, what methods were used, you know, whether people, you know, fled out of fear, whether they were told by Arab leaders to leave their homes, or whether they were massacred. The point is, at the end of the day, they were all expelled because expulsion is denying their right to return. After a war, people have the right to return. This is acknowledged by the United Nations. And when there's a war that happens, any war, what usually happens is that people will return. Civilians who flee have the right, and they return home after the war. Palestinians have been denied this right to return until today. And precisely because of the battle for numbers, it was the only way they could, the Zionist movement could ensure a Jewish state, a Jewish majority state, I should say. We refer to the sequence of events as al-Nakba. Al-Nakba means the catastrophe. The Palestinian catastrophe. This is our tragedy. The Palestinian catastrophe, the Nakba, belongs on the list of denied tragedies in the world, such as the Holocaust. There are Holocaust deniers out there, we know that. And there are also people who deny the Nakba. Most Zionists deny the Nakba. They don't acknowledge that this happened. They will say Arab leaders told the Palestinians to leave so that they can come in and destroy the Jewish state, and then the Palestinians could come back. This is the narrative. It's ridiculous. It's like the Pied Piper of Hamelin. You know, they say leave and everybody gets up and just leaves out of hatred for the Jews. This is the narrative. Thankfully, there are Israelis who are acknowledging the reality of what happened, but the extent of it is still a big issue. And I commend the Israeli organization called Zokrot. Zokrot means remembering in Hebrew. It's a small organization, but it does great work in raising awareness to the Israeli public about the Nakba. They take people on tours in Israel to former Palestinian villages and show them all that remains. The Armenian genocide, I just wanted to add, is another denied tragedy that we should recognize. The identity of the Kurds, another issue we should pay attention to and recognize. The genocide of the Tamil people by the Sri Lankan state. We need to be consistent. Not just recognize one tragedy and deny the other. It's shameful. In 1949, Israel expropriated all of the land that Palestinians had fled or had been expelled from. Israel passed the absentee property law. The absentee property law says that all those who weren't present during 1948, all those who left, now their property is state property. It's under the control of the state. These were homes. Some families, Palestinian families, left pots with food still on the stove. They thought they were coming back soon. There were toys, children's toys. And these are accounts that I'm trying to remember here. Not only of Palestinians, but of Haganah soldiers who recount their experience going into these homes and removing people. There were children's toys still on the floor. There were families who lost family members along the way and were never reunited, never found them again. In Haifa, one more thing about this, in Haifa has a port. People were shot at until they ran to the beach and got on boats and left. This is important because today Palestinians are accused of wanting to drive Jews into the sea. Palestinians had already been driven into the sea. This happened. Families were pushed literally into the sea. People drowned when the boats left. In 1964, the Palestine Liberation Organization is formed under the leadership of the Fatah movement, led by Yasser Arafat, with the goal of liberating Palestine. And I have to be specific here. The goal meant a democratic, secular state for everybody who lived there. Yes, that was in the charter of the Palestine Liberation Organization, or Fatah, one or the other. They announced that they wanted their goal was a single democratic state. Their goal was the right of return, basically. Their goal was that refugees who were expelled should be allowed to return and establish a state for both peoples who were living there. The United Nations passed Resolution 194, and this is the most important resolution for Palestinians. UN General Assembly Resolution 194 calls for the right of return of refugees. And obviously, Israel is in violation of that resolution until today. And the PLO takes up armed struggle and begins to fight Israel. In 1967, there is another war between Egypt, Syria, and Jordan. Israel, by the end of the war, it only lasts 6 days, Israel takes over the rest of Palestine. It takes Gaza from Egypt and the West Bank from Jordan, because after the Nakba, Jordan took the West Bank, controlled it, and Egypt took Gaza and controlled it. And the West Bank and Gaza and East Jerusalem, those make up 22% of Palestine. So Israel was established on 78%. The remaining 22% was West Bank, Gaza, and East Jerusalem. And those were controlled by Egypt and Jordan. And in 1967, following that war, Israel took the rest. They took over the West Bank, they took over Gaza, they took East Jerusalem. Now they had all of Palestine under Israeli control. However, and this is important, Israel didn't annex those territories. And annex means to make it part of the country, officially part of the country, and impose civilian law. No. And there's a reason why it didn't annex those territories. A very important reason that I think is usually missed. And again, the answer is that it goes back to the demographic issue, to the battle for numbers. If they had annexed those territories, they would have had to give citizenship, Israeli citizenship and civil rights to the Palestinians living there. But they couldn't, because then they would have a problem with the numbers, and the Jewish majority would be threatened again. So instead of doing that, they imposed military law in order to build Jewish settlements in the West Bank and Gaza. They expanded into the West Bank and Gaza by building settlements, Jewish settlements, and these settlements are illegal under international law. Article 49 of the Geneva Convention, which Israel signed, says that an occupying power cannot transfer parts of its population into the territory it occupies. Yet Israel is still doing that, and it's a major issue today, as we know. Illegal settlements are being built into the West Bank today. Palestinian land is being expropriated in the West Bank, in the occupied territories. It is being expropriated. However, Palestinians weren't given rights. They weren't given Israeli citizenship. They had no say in anything. And life under military rule was characterized by land expropriation, by settlements, by restrictions on movement. Military checkpoints are set up to control freedom of movement. There were different road systems that were established for settlers and Palestinians. Israeli settlers drive on their own roads, and Palestinians drive on their own roads. Palestinian cars have different license plate colors than Israeli cars. Palestinians have to have an ID that they have to show at the military checkpoints where they are routinely searched. Palestinians have to wake up at 3 in the morning, 4 in the morning, just to make it to work, because what is a trip that would take 10 minutes to get to work, now because of the checkpoints, takes 4 hours. I knew somebody who had to wake up at 3, 4 a.m. every day to go to school, because it takes 4 hours for him to get to school when the school is actually 20 minutes away. And he made it through high school, I'm happy to say. And this was done for the protection of the settlers, to protect them. Because obviously, when you expropriate somebody's land, somebody's going to be angry about it. And so they had to provide security. So they would build the settlements and then surround them with the Israeli army in order to protect them. And Palestinian communities would be policed by the Israeli army. And this reality went on until, well, still going on today, but in 1987, the Palestinians in the occupied territories finally revolted. They rose up against the Israeli army in what we call the First Intifada. The Intifada means uprising, and that was the first Palestinian uprising against the military occupation of the West Bank and Gaza and East Jerusalem. It was characterized by stone throwing. It was famous on TV in the 80s at the time. I was like 7 years old at the time. I remember the footage on TV of children my age sometimes, and young people, men and women, grabbing stones and throwing them at the Israeli army, at the soldiers, telling them to get out of our neighborhood. Stop telling me what to do. I'm sick of it. They would sometimes confront tanks in the street with stones. And this was bad for Israel's image in the media. The child in front of the tank. It made them look bad. And they had to come up with a solution to quell the uprising. There's another reason why they wanted to find a solution. And this is a reason that's often overlooked. In 1991, I think, somewhere around that time, the chief Israeli demographer, who looks at the population numbers, freaks out. He goes to Yitzhak Rabin, the prime minister of Israel at the time, and he says, "We have a problem. The numbers, the population of Palestinians is growing fast. And I project in 20 years, they're going to outnumber Jews. There will be more Palestinians under Israeli control in the West Bank, Gaza, East Jerusalem, and in Israel proper. There will be more Palestinians in the whole territory under Israeli control than Jews." This was a problem, because people by this time were pissed off at apartheid South Africa. The apartheid regime in South Africa was collapsing. It was being isolated by boycott, divestment, and sanctions. People were boycotting it. Ordinary people like you and me. I don't know if you know, but York University divested from South Africa in 1985. And so he says, you gotta find a solution for this. We can't stay in control of the occupied territories, or else we're in trouble. The world's gonna look at us as an apartheid state. And this was another reason why Yitzhak Rabin finally signed the peace process, the Oslo Accords, as we know them. In 1993, the PLO and the Israeli government signed the peace process. And they began a process which it was understood that by 5 years, there would be two states. There would be Israel, and Palestinians would establish their state in the occupied territories. The West Bank, Gaza, and East Jerusalem, the capital of the Palestinian state. There were issues with that. One of the biggest is the right of return for refugees who have the right to decide if they wanted to return to Israel proper, to their old villages, or to be compensated. There's actually a concept called land restitution. It's a conflict resolution concept. Land restitution. So if refugees do return, they don't have to be given the same exact property that they had. They can be given property from somewhere else in the same area if they're satisfied with that. And that's restituting victims by giving them land. Or compensating them, I should say. But that was an issue with the peace process. That's still an issue today. For Israelis, Jerusalem is a huge issue. Every Israeli government until today, since the peace process, has rejected dividing Jerusalem. They won't leave East Jerusalem. They're very stubborn about it. Jerusalem is a big deal for the Zionist movement. And so there were these kinds of issues with the peace process. However, the biggest problem was that throughout the 90s, it became apparent that what Israel was trying to do throughout the peace process was to take the most amount of land from the West Bank with the least amount of Palestinians. They would expand settlements and expropriate the land, and then they would come to the negotiating table and say, well, this is our portion. What do you want? There's a concept that is used by some Palestinian activists today and journalists called the pizza analogy. Now, the pizza analogy is very simple. The pizza analogy is you and me are negotiating over a pizza, who gets how many slices. But while we're negotiating, I'm eating from the pizza. So this has been, to put it in a nutshell, very briefly, this has been Israel's behavior during the peace process. And this is why the main reason why the peace process collapsed. And today it's still eating from the pizza. It's still building settlements in defiance of international law and the United States itself. The U.S. doesn't even recognize Israel's control of East Jerusalem. And what happened then is that the Bantustan solutions, it started to become apparent that the peace process was a Bantustan solution. What is a Bantustan? In South Africa, the white minority government proposed to the black majority at one point that here, we'll give you a piece of land here, a piece of land there, and you can call that the South Africa. You can call that your state. And this was rejected by Nelson Mandela. This was rejected by the African National Congress. And so it became apparent that Israel was trying to do the same thing. This was history repeating itself. There was one Palestinian town here, one here, surrounded by the Israeli army, surrounded by settlements, and they say, well, you can call those communities, you know, you can call that a state, the Palestinian state, and we're just going to keep taking more. And this is still happening today. So with the failure of the peace process, the second intifada begins in the year 2000. The second intifada, unfortunately, takes a more violent turn. Palestinians are really pissed off now. We see attacks against Israeli civilians intensify, and I should be very clear about my own views. I do not support attacks against civilians, whether they're Israeli or Palestinian. I do not support those actions. I think they've done more harm than good anyway, on top of being completely immoral and unjustified. We can understand the context that they happen, though. We understand that these people who commit these atrocities were born in refugee camps in miserable conditions, many in Gaza, who have felt a sense of hopelessness and loss. The rise of Islamism was taking place at that time, and Hamas was born from the refugee camps in Gaza. Hamas was born as a reactionary Islamist movement, but when we think of Hamas, we don't have to support its tactics, we don't have to support its ideology, but we do have an obligation to understand the context that it was born in. One of those, as I explained, is the miserable conditions. Another is that people should know that Hamas was funded by Israel. Israel gave grants to the founder of Hamas, Ahmad Yassin, in order to establish the movement, because they wanted to divide the Palestinian leadership. They wanted to get back at the PLO by dividing Palestinians. They gave grants, they gave money for him to establish institutions that became Hamas. And hey, it's worked. So far. Another way to understand Hamas, and I think this is very important, look at other struggles in the region, in the world that have happened. Look at South Africa. In South Africa, there was the Black Consciousness Movement. So we had the ANC, the African National Congress of Nelson Mandela, and we had the Black Consciousness Movement. The Black Consciousness Movement was more extremist. They were more violent. They used to put tires around people's necks and light them on fire. But the question is, did we stop supporting the struggle of South Africans? Did we change our level of support? No, of course not. We still recognized the struggle of South Africans for freedom, even though these violent actions were taken. Same thing with Palestine. That's how we should see it. In fact, there isn't a national liberation movement in the history of the world that didn't take up violence, that didn't use violence. Even the Black Panthers in the United States used violent methods, armed struggle. Now, of course, attacking civilians again is unjustified. I don't support it. But we have to understand the context. Did we stop supporting the civil rights movement? No. So why would we stop supporting the Palestinian movement? Because of Hamas. Of course, I'm not going to go into any detail about Israel's attacks on Gaza. That's for another talk. But we've seen what's been happening recently. Operation Cast Lead, 1,400 Palestinians were killed. Operation Protective Edge over the summer, 2,200 Palestinians were killed. Hundreds of thousands of homes, people expelled and tens of thousands of homes demolished. We've seen the images. It's despicable. These are people living in ghettos, people in refugee camps. In fact, I should emphasize that Gaza, 80% of Gazans are not from Gaza. I am. I belong to that 20%. That are from Gaza going back 1,000 years. But 80% of Palestinians in Gaza are not from Gaza. They're refugees. They used to live in Israel. They were kicked out in 1948 in the Nakba. And now they're still in refugee camps languishing in Gaza. These are the ones who are fighting. They want to go back home. They're literally, they were concentrated, just moved, pushed out of Israel and concentrated in this piece of land, Gaza, the most densely populated area in the world. And that's why it's the most densely populated, because the people aren't from there. The situation today is that Israel and the West Bank have been integrated because of the Israeli settlements. It's hard to make a distinction. It's hard to separate them. Separating the West Bank from Israel is difficult. Settlements are still being built. East Jerusalem is not to be divided. This is an Israeli position by all Zionist political parties. 500,000 settlers live in the illegal settlements in the West Bank and East Jerusalem, and they threaten war if the Israeli government tries to remove them. They threaten a civil war. Out of this reality, out of the failure of the peace process, the failure of the failure of the world to do something to fix the situation, the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement was born. BDS attempts to do what was done to South Africa, where ordinary people like you and me, anywhere in the world, but especially here, can participate and take action by boycotting, divesting, and by pressuring our governments to sanction Israel. Now, of course, it's a much harder job with Israel because of how much support Israel has with the governments here, especially Canada, the Canadian government. Harper is extremely supportive of Israel, more than Israel itself. But because of the failure of world powers to hold Israel accountable for its violations of international law, it is our responsibility to take up the cause of BDS. And Palestinians, this is important, unlike other places in the world, Palestinians, specifically Palestinians, have called on the world to impose BDS. In 2005, they released a statement. 170 Palestinian civil society organizations, like student unions, medical associations, labor unions, they released a statement saying, world, you guys, please, start BDS. You did it to South Africa. You can do it to Israel. And I challenge anybody who disagrees with BDS against Israeli apartheid, I challenge them to be consistent, at least be consistent, and condemn BDS against South Africa that took place. Condemn it. And everybody knows that if you condemn BDS against South Africa, you're a racist. You'd be called a racist. Like Stephen Harper. who disagreed with BDS against South Africa. The BDS movement uses international law and legitimacy. It says the solution is international law. It says that Israel has to fulfill its obligations under international law. It's a rights-based approach. It doesn't take any political solution, but it says that Israel has to respect Palestinian rights. Israel should be boycotted, divested from, and sanctioned until it, one, ends its occupation of the occupied territories, West Bank, Gaza, and East Jerusalem. You know, ends its military law over those territories. It respects Palestinians with Israeli citizenship, their rights, and it allows the Palestinian refugees their right to return. Now, one thing I forgot I just want to go back to and mention is the Palestinian citizens of Israel. This is important because they're usually forgotten. The Palestinian citizens of Israel, those who remained in Israel after the Nakba, they actually had to live under military law for many years, I think 20 years or so. They now have Israeli citizenship. They have their own political parties. They can vote in the Israeli government. But basically, this is where their rights end. They are completely discriminated against in terms of public services, education. Israel hasn't built any home, any villages or cities for them. There is this is important too, 25% of them, a quarter of them, live in unrecognized villages. They are internally displaced people. They were expelled during the Nakba from their homes, but were not pushed out of the border of Israel. They were expelled from their homes. They're still not allowed to reclaim those homes, those properties, but although they're Israeli citizens. Some Palestinian citizens of Israel can see their former properties. They can see their homes and their neighborhoods just across the street, but they're not allowed to cross that street. They're not allowed. And so they have built new villages, and those new, these new villages are not recognized by the Israeli government. And what does that entail? That entails you don't get roads, you don't get water, you don't get electricity. One of these villages, you have to drive around a ditch just to get to. And these are citizens of Israel. So finally, in the absence of creating a viable Palestinian state, in the absence of a workable two-state solution, Israel has three choices. One, it could try ethnic cleansing, as it did before. There could be a second Nakba, where it would expel Palestinians again, in mass numbers. And it's important to note that it does that today, but on a much smaller scale than the Nakba. So people in the West Bank regularly have Israeli soldiers coming up to their homes, knocking on their doors at 4 in the morning, being like, you have 15 minutes to get your children, get your belongings, get out of here. Your property just became state property. This happens regularly. That's how they confiscate your home for settlement construction. But one thing Israel can do is expel everybody. The world is now, thankfully because of BDS, the world would probably extremely disapprove of Israel doing that, but who knows, we just saw what they did in Gaza. The second thing Israel could do is maintain the status quo and continue its building settlements, but it faces a growing international movement, such as ourselves, condemning it, and increased BDS pressure, and the world is definitely seeing Israel as an apartheid state because of this. And the third thing that Israel can do is give equal rights for everybody. Give Palestinians their rights. Give them Israeli citizenship, integrate the territories, have civil rights, give them civil rights. And that's going to be up to Palestinians and Israelis to really push for that to happen. The Palestinian Liberation Movement has a lot of thinking to do going forward, whether it wants to continue to pressure for an independent Palestinian state, or whether it wants to take up the one-state solution where simply, you know, we call for the right to vote in the Israeli parliament. And people aren't strangers to that demand. As, you know, just like in South Africa and in the civil rights movement, people wanted the right to vote. And this could be something that may end up taking place going forward in the near future. So to end off, I would just like to say a quote from the great Palestinian intellectual Edward Said, who left us in 2003. He said, "I have spent a great deal of my life during the 35 years advocating the rights of the Palestinian people to national self-determination. But I have always tried to do that with full attention paid to the reality of the Jewish people and what they suffered by way of persecution and genocide. The paramount thing is that the struggle for equality in Palestine, Israel, should be directed toward a humane goal, that is, coexistence, and not further suppression and denial." Thank you. I'm just going to show two slideshows now before we go into question and answer. Apple.
These are Palestinians at the port of Haifa. literally being shot at from the hills, from the top of buildings as well, telling them to, pushing them into the sea. Yasser Arafat, leader of the PLO, Palestinian Resistance, the Palestine Liberation Organization. Images of the Intifada.
First or second?
This is the first. These are settlements, illegal settlements today being built in the West Bank, and this is what they look like. This is the wall that Israel is currently building. These are Palestinian workers at 4 in the morning going to work. They have to pass through this military checkpoint before they can get to work. And there are soldiers around them. There's another one. This is daily life. This is Gaza after what happened this summer. And this map is helpful. What you're seeing, the second piece is the UN partition plan. The third piece is Israel and the occupied territories, the West Bank on the right, Gaza on the left. And then today, the situation, you can see the West Bank today, what's left of it, because of Israeli settlements that are being built inside. So just going back here for a moment, I wonder, where are we going to create a Palestinian state? In here. Where? That's a big question we have to ask ourselves. When people ask you, what do Palestinians want? This is the main thing. We want to return to our homeland. It's a struggle for return, which is enshrined in international law, UN Resolution 194. So international legality is on our side. Now I'll just show you this slideshow that I made years ago about the Nakba.
Thank you so much, Hammam, for that very important and informative talk. It's only through our knowledge of the root causes can we continue the fight for justice and equality for all. But before we go into Q&A, we're just gonna, where's the petition?
Should be at the back.
Okay, so we're just gonna pass that petition where we're requesting the Board of Governors to divest from military contributions. So we'd really appreciate it if you could all sign it. Make sure to look at our website online, www.saiayork.org, and like us on Facebook and Twitter. Woo. Okay, so Q&A, I'll take three questions and three questions. I'll be an answer to those questions. So if anyone has any, please feel free, not be shy, we will be on mic.
Yeah, what you say to people who say that the two-state solution can no longer work, and it's going to be either a one-state solution or that the board may have too much power and it really shares power?
Well, that's a, it's not an easy question. I mean, the two-state solution, like I said, there are problems, there are issues, it's difficult. At the same time, it is recognized by literally, like, virtually every government in the world sees that the two-state solution is the way that that should happen. So we don't know whether it's going to be workable or not. It's really in Israel's hands for the most part, because it keeps building settlements. Even the United States is upset about that. So when Israel is ready to sit down, stop settlement construction, and negotiate a two-state solution, then maybe that can happen. If it doesn't happen, and so far there hasn't been any indication, and that's the important part, there isn't any indication that an Israeli government is willing to sit down and actually talk about a workable two-state solution, then we'll start talking.